Hey friends, did you know that you can write stateful functions in a serverless compute environment? Durable Functions is an extension of Azure Functions that helps you define stateful workflows. David Justo is here to show me how that works today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with David Justo. He's going to show me durable functions. How are you?
Pretty good, Scott. Thank you for having me. How are you doing this Friday?
I'm living the dream. I'm learning all about fun things on Azure, and that's always a good Friday.
All right. Yeah. I'm excited to tell you all about bringing state back to the serverless space.
So is that a good thing or a bad thing? Is this an architectural decision? Because I know that we spent all this time trying to make things stateless because stateless things scale, but sometimes business processes really need state. It's easier to express. It's easier to write. So is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, I would say that's a good thing. I mean, you're right. The serverless programming model has for a long time been constrained to be stateless, precisely because it's good for scaling. It just makes it easier if you're a serverless provider to have things this way. But at the end of the day, you know, these are constraints that we're talking about, and so they make it difficult to implement certain kinds of applications you would want to see. Mm-hmm. And durable functions makes that easier. And I guess that now that we're on it, how about I share my screen? I'd love to just to get straight into it.
Let's do it. Let's see your demo.
Okay. Let's see what's going on. I actually wanted to start by just establishing some context, which you actually already helped me get started with. So as you all know, if any of you has been in the serverless space for any amount of time, you would know that trying to incorporate state into the serverless space is rather difficult. And the reason being that you have these constraints, right? That your functions should be short-lived and that they should be stateless. And so even though there's many applications that fit these constraints rather well, there's certain application patterns that won't fit quite nicely into this model. And so I want to give you an example, Scott. Let's say that you want to implement a simple pipeline, right? That you want to have a kind of service on the cloud that downloads a data set, you know, runs some function over it that processes that data set in some way, so you calculate some statistic, and then sends the result of that statistic to the user, say via an email. You may try to fit all of this into one serverless function just for convenience, but you would quickly run into timing issues, most likely, because functions are supposed to be like quick, single purpose. And so you'll probably find yourself having to split it up into small different pieces, maybe one per step, say one function to download, another function to process, and another function to send the results. And this is when things start getting tricky, and surprisingly, because this is supposed to be a simple pipeline. But in the serverless space, since you don't have an easy way to communicate state forward, you're probably going to have to reinvent certain programming constructs, just like variable passing. And variable passing you would probably take for granted in most programming languages. But in serverless, if you're trying to pass variables across functions, you probably have to coordinate with an external queue. So what durable functions does is it's going to give you that stateful glue that's going to allow you to establish these connections between functions that pass that state around and allow you to implement these kinds of pipelines on the cloud. So this is one kind of application, right, that the durable functions can help you out with. There's another one that I'm particularly excited about, and that's something we call fanning out and fanning in. And you'll probably be familiar with this if you're familiar with MapReduce style operations. So going with the example, let's say you have one starting function, then download some data off the internet, and then per every data point in that data set, let's say you're running some transformation function and you decide to do that in parallel because that's the whole thing about the cloud, right? You know, this elastic scaling that you get on demand. So you run those things in parallel and then you want to do that reduce step where you aggregate the results back in. For the same reasons as before, doing this aggregation of results is difficult in a serverless space, because we have no good way of determining when parallel work has concluded. And yet again, durable function here is going to give you the primitives and abstractions that are going to allow you to complete that workflow, if that makes sense, that stateful workflow. And so just to emphasize the takeaways, durable functions allows you to orchestrate multiple purpose programs in a serverless environment that can be long-lived, potentially non-terminating, and they do this by accessing persistent state. And the kinds of things this is going to enable are pipelines like we talked about, finding out, finding in, which is this MapReduce style operation, and other things such as correlating external events, monitoring long-running processes on the web, implementing HTTP-based long-running APIs, and implementing the kinds of services that allow for human-in-the-loop interruptions. And that's what durable functions is kind of all about.
So interesting. Let me ask this, though. So I could, as a programmer, use regular Azure functions and the existing storage primitives that I have available to me, whether they be queues or tables or, you know, Cosmos DB, as kind of an external coordinator. But I'm hearing you say that that's really not in the scope of what my business person or the person who is in charge of me that asked me to write. You're basically saying, work on the thing that you need to work on. We have primitives in Azure Functions and durable functions that allow you to do this. So that all that administrivia of me trying to coordinate external state, and probably I'll probably get it wrong when I do it. I don't have to think about that.
That's exactly right, Scott. Like you said, the main idea is that when trying to implement these kinds of things, it is possible with standard serverless solutions, but you will probably have to re-implement certain programming primitives because you're operating in a stateless environment.
So, exactly.
Durable functions is going to give you a programmatic way of tying it all together.
Okay, so then that means, you know, the kinds of things that I would do with regular code, sharing state, passing variables, try catches and things like that, all of those kind of Lego pieces are available to me now with durable functions.
Exactly. And in fact, I'd love to show you an example just to get this more concrete in our heads.
How about Please, that? Absolutely.
All right, so I'm gonna switch to Visual Studio Code. And what I have right here is that first simple pipeline we talked about, right? So what we're looking at here is what we call an orchestrator function, which is a durable functions concept that is essentially this stateful glue that ties together serverless functions in Azure, right? And so you can see here just at a high level that we have as a first step, this kind of like download data step that's going to download some data, and we can get that result into a standard Python variable and pass that around to the next step that's going to count something in that data, get the those results back, and pass that forward to this write message operation. And so if this code looks simple, that's kind of the point. Because without it, you would probably have to coordinate with registering external queues, and just doing all sorts of declarative mumbo jumbo, which here you can just express imperatively and programmatically.
I think imperative mumbo jumbo. Dick, was it imperative mumbo jumbo? I think that's the correct technical term for what you have to do, because it is a hassle. And having those primitives in durable functions makes it a lot easier.
It does. And in fact, one of the things, you know, because this is simple variable passing, right? One of the things that durable functions is particularly powerful in is in recovering from exceptional outputs, so exceptions. So let's say that, you know, in this case, as you can probably infer from the code, we're downloading data of the Wikipedia article for the Python programming language. I'm gonna switch to a slightly different version of this code, right? So I'm switching right here to a slightly modified version of that code that instead of trying to download from the Python article, is trying to find an article for the language Snaky Snake, which obviously doesn't exist, but it probably should. In that case, if we try to download, data from that article, we'll probably get a 404, and we'll probably get an exception back. Trying to recover from exceptions in standard serverless, it's a nightmare. Because now you have this extra layer of coordination that you have to worry about, and having to think about things like retries gets hairy rather quickly. So in durable functions, you can just reuse simple try except blocks to express these recovering mechanisms in the ways that you're already familiar with, in the ways that programmers already are used to working in. So this is one of the things I'm particularly excited about.
So how are you doing that? You're saying that you're taking the language primitive that I'm used to using and extending it to the web itself.
That's the magic. That's right. Yeah. The way we're doing it is, so some, you know, listeners that work in the .NET environment might be familiar with the durable task framework.
Yeah.
In, you know, like behind the curtain, we actually hook up to the durable task framework. That's really where the name durable functions comes in. And we use that to help us orchestrate these, you know, task parallel orchestrations of code in a distributed fashion.
Interesting.
And this is just happens to be the Python SDK that we've built on top of that.
Yeah, and that's up on GitHub, by the way, just as a side note for people. People can go to azure.durabletask and they can read about that task format and they can basically learn that in C# and apply it to other things as well. So just as a little aside.
Right. And so I'd love to get this running just on the right, you know, just so I can prove that this is not just static code. So if I may, what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to expand my terminal and start the Azure Functions local server with func/host start. And when we do that, we're going to get these handy sort of like listing of these sort of functions that have been declared. And you'll see right here that we've created this HTTP endpoint that we can hit and specify an orchestrator name to kickstart our orchestration, right? And so here, the orchestrations we've defined happen to be the simple sequential orchestrator that I talked about first and the error handling one. And so just to show how like a simple hello world example would look like, switching to Postman. Before I move forward, is this readable, Scott? Should I make this any bigger for the viewers?
No, I think that looks great. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. So here I have essentially that now parameterized URL. And I'm going to hit it with a send. And what I'm going to get back is this JSON of URLs that are going to allow us to interact with these orchestrator functions in a variety of ways. But right now, for example purposes, let's just focus on this status query get URI one, which is just going to give us just a general overview of the status of that orchestration. So I'm going to click on that. I'm going to send that request. And our result, we get, hey, this orchestration has completed, and its output was that you found a total of 1,446 lines in that Wikipedia article on the Python programming language. And similarly, let me close this one. If we wanted to see the result for the error handling orchestrator that I showed, we can hit it, go to that same status URI, get that request as well. And we see, hey, it's completed. And in fact, you could not find the article requested. So in just a few lines of code, we can express these pipelines, and we can express these pipelines by including error recovery as well.
And so that is very clean.
It is clean. It is clean and it is simple. It doesn't take that much time to pick up on. The last thing, Scott, I wanted to show you was this kind of like elastic parallelization pattern that I talked about, fan out, fan in.
Yeah.
And so here's what we're going to do. It's going to be a bit of more of a realistic application.
All right.
So what I have right here is a website that has been deployed on Azure. And in its backend, it's going to be powered by durable functions. And so what this website's going to do is it's going to download a given number of images of the internet of either dogs or cats. And using durable functions, it's going to, in parallel, load a TensorFlow model and try to predict whether or not it's a cat or a dog. And as those results start coming in, we're going to see on the website, sort of like our predictions start populate the page. Now, before I click on that classify images button, I just want to highlight the code. So I'm going to go to VS Code again, and just a high level breakdown of what we're looking at here. So number one, as you see, this is an orchestrator function. As you see, orchestrators can get input dynamically. And what we're doing first is we're downloading pictures of the internet to classify. Then, and this is the important bit, we're creating an array of tasks that we are populating for every image that we downloaded with a task to classify that image. And instead of calling yield on every one of those tasks, we're going to use this durable functions API called task all that's going to say, hey, for everything in that array of tasks, do it in parallel and give me all the results back. So this is how we can get to express those MapReduce style operations. So with all that being said, I'm going to switch back. Let's say we want to classify 100 images, and let's watch it roll. And so the first thing we're going to do is, you know, go off the internet. We're going to download a bunch of images. That may take a second. And then you're going to start see, you know, the pictures and our predictions populate the page. And hopefully, you'll see that elastic scaling start taking place as the speed of our results sort of like accelerates as Azure realizes that, oh, the demand is increasing. Let me give you more workers to work on. So this could be, you know, at any given point in time, this could be running on hundreds of nodes. And you could classify all your cats and dogs. Next time you're confused, Azure durable functions, get your back.
It sounds like you could actually probably go faster than the browser could handle there. You went from like a, you know, half of a cat a second to 5, 6, 10 and going faster and faster. You could go faster than your browser can handle that.
You could probably go faster. That's right.
That's amazing.
Yeah, absolutely. So these are the kinds of things that would normally take quite a bit of, you know, overhead to orchestrate in the serverless space. And now it's a little bit easier. And that's what I'm excited about it.
That's great. What I like about this is that it layers just so cleanly on top of Azure Functions. So people who are familiar with basic Azure Functions or basic serverless concepts, it's very comfortable. It layers on top very cleanly. I like that you're not making us learn any new primitives. If you know how to do exception handling, if you know how to do, I mean, that was a pretty naive for loop. And you fanned out very nicely to categorize all of our dogs and cats.
That's right. And, you know, like right now, you know, we're talking about Azure durable functions for Python, but as it turns out, we also have bindings for JavaScript and C# for these durable functions programming model. And hopefully in the future, we'll see it in more and more offerings. I would love to see it in a more niche language as well, like Haskell, or just something people wouldn't normally expect. So keep an eye out for that as well.
Very cool. Go ahead and make sure that you check out the show notes. We'll have links to durable functions for .NET, for Python, for JavaScript, as well as the overview. I'm learning all about Azure Durable Functions today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.